Oh boy, look at those deep sky objects. I see the Pleiades there from up on top of White Top Mountain in Damascus, Virginia. Hi, everybody. I'm Stargazer Mark, and I'm so glad you're with us to stay star curious on Stay Curious, our Monday program here at the American Space Museum. And we're so glad that you're watching us today. Yes, I'm looking at some stars from top of a mountain called White Top Mountain in Damascus, Virginia, just on the other side of the Tennessee border, kind of north of Asheville, North Carolina, even. And thanks to George Fleener, a good buddy of mine for over 40 years, who took this photograph, and we love sharing amateur astronomers' photos out there. And we got a few that are wonderful Stay Curious watchers, including Dan Vranick in Fort Wayne, Indiana. He does some great astrophotography you ought to check out. But so we're here staying star curious. I got my red flashlight, I got my binoculars, my planisphere, my sky chart, so I know what's going on. As y'all know, red flashlight, I can read in the night my charts and so forth without my eyes contracting the pupils back to tiny little slits after they open up wide and dilate to let more light in. And that's an important part of stargazing. Well, this week in January, it's full moon today on this is Monday, January 17th, 2022. And I got Marty Winkle, my cameraman, co-producer, working the Streamlabs board today.
MLK Day in the U.S.
They're what?
MLK, Martin
Oh, and
Luther
it's
King.
Martin Luther King Day in the United States. A great holiday to celebrate. We've had a lot of people in the museum today, in fact. And we had three docents this morning giving tours to a scout group. So, Martin Luther King Day, a time to reflect back on civil rights and all that you can do for that movement of equality. And we preach that all the time here at your favorite nonprofit, the American Space Museum, where for over 21 years we have been preserving the birth of the American space age right here in its delivery room, just in Brevard County. And I'm just 9 miles away from a launch pad that's going to launch a Falcon 9 rocket tonight, 10th time for this first stage, to send up some more communication satellites, which astronomers really don't like because they mess with some of their photos. But Elon Musk knows that he's got to appease the scientific community, and he's doing things to make those Starlink satellites less interruptive to the serious astronomers out there. But we want to talk about backyard astronomers like you and me. And I've been doing backyard astronomy for 60 years. And like I always say, how much do you have to know about something to be still be called an amateur? Because I'm an amateur astronomer, not a professional. But like I say, we're a peculiar bunch of scientists because, Marty, I've never seen an amateur biologist carve up a frog on the street to a bunch of people. But I sure have seen a long line in front of my telescope to see Jupiter and Saturn's moon, Jupiter's moons and Saturn's rings. So we're glad that you're with us every Monday. Once a week, we do backyard astronomy, things that you can just see from your normal backyard. But on a full moon like we have today, wolf full moon, it's not a good night for stargazing. So I'm going to take the cue from Christopher Lusardi, who on our YouTube channel last week, he watched our Stay Curious, Star Curious backyard astronomy program on moon maps. Thank you, Christopher Lusardo, who asks, what are some of the best books to learn how to become and be a good backyard astronomer? And how good of a library do I have to be successful? Where should I start? How should I incrementally add to my library? Well, Christopher Lusardi, you're going to regret that you asked that question because I am a bookworm from nowhere else, as are most amateur astronomers. And I got to pull off the shelves of some of the little libraries I have around my own home and here at the museum, some of my favorite books to kind of show you how to get started and in the plethora of books out there that are so unique and beautiful. A lot of them just gorgeous works of art. But all of them informative. But a word about the full moon. The wolf moon is what the Native Americans called the full moon of January. Why? Because wolves were baying in the night because they were so hungry. And the Native Americans could hardly sleep. Some of them said that the wolves were so hungry looking for food, they'd be crying at the moon in the night because all those little furry creatures that they would prey on had burrowed into their nests or were in hibernation or had built dams like beavers to hide. So, and there weren't the berries and vegetation things to sustain them. So that's where we get the wolf moon of January. So go out there and get you a little moonshine, the kind of moonshine you can't get too much of tonight for this full moon. Now, as I take a sip of rocket fuel and caution, I might start randomly talking about astronomy. Thank you, my buddy Marty there. He got me that for Christmas a couple years ago. You got to have a little something out when you're stargazing, but all the time people think full moon is a good time to stargaze, and it's the worst time. That bright moon shining, the second brightest thing in the sky at minus 17 magnitude, to throw out a little astronomy for you there, it drowns out all of the nebulas and galaxies and star clusters that we like to find with binoculars and telescopes. So the star charts that I'm going to show you might have less than half the stars on them when the full moon's out, so it's not a good time to see it. Plus, there's no shadow detail along the day and night line of the moon. It's called the Terminator. Nothing to do with Arnold Schwarzenegger, but the Terminator is our daylight and nighttime on Earth, and it's the same dividing line between night and day on the moon. That's where you see a lot of beautiful shadow detail that the eye really appeals to. So you don't see a lot of relief. Full moon does have its own features, like the bright rays of craters that had splattered into the moon millions of years ago. So I thought it'd be good and timely. Christopher Lusardi asking the question about what are some best books to learn. And I thought, you know what? I'm just going to take you right down the line about books in astronomy. And the first place you want to start is your public library or your school library, because there are a lot of books there that you can buy on the open market. And by the way, a lot of books I show you are on Amazon and other book sources for pennies on the dollar. All right. If you want to support your local Barnes & Noble and Books A Million, please do. But a lot of these books you can get virtually pretty cheap, and used is used. What makes it unique about astronomy is a book from the 1950s, like this one that I grew up with, Stars by Herbert Zim. This is a basic book of astronomy from 1951, and it starts talking about rainbows, which is and sunspots. But the stars in there, the star charts are never going to change. They haven't changed in millions of years. What has changed is the positions of the planets on a chart like this, where it talks about where the planets are. Good Lord, this goes through 1970. All right. In this book. Of course, that's updated, and what we know about planets and things like, we didn't know about black holes in the 50s and stuff like that. That is the only difference. But the starry night from your backyard is the same in this 1951 book that I've had in my library since I was a little boy. And looking for a little sky observer's guide, a little paperback like this that has things in there from all about telescopes. Every one of these will teach you about a telescope. Here's sketching the moon, like I've talked about, and so on. These are indispensable, but this is a handy little, one of my first little star charts to take out into the night sky at my first telescope. We'll try to find a chart there. Very informative about telescopes and things like that. Cliff Watson. Hey, Cliff. He's down there in Australia, buddy. Good friend of mine. 99 stars. Appreciate that. Old Cliff's down there enjoying the first days of summer. I'll bet he's out there working on one of his fancy cars out there in his under a shade tree. Good to see you, Cliff. He's in Pomona, Australia. And Adrian Padrick. Thank you, Adrian. Appreciate that. Appreciate your stars, Cliff. You can contribute stars to our American Space Museum Facebook page. That's a penny a star. And we love you watching on YouTube. We had Christopher Lusardi, and today's topic is dedicated to his question of what books should you have in your library to get started. We're also on Twitch and Spotify, and we're moving our program audio on Google and Apple. So trying to be as descriptive as we can today for all you audio people. that are listening to us.
Maybe buy some of those books, Amazon Smile.
And thank you, Marty, for reminding me. Amazon Smile is how you want to register on Amazon for your nonprofit to buy any of these books. And I guarantee you 90% of them are available, and some of them are classics. And but I wanted to tease today one of the first books of astronomy. I showed you a couple of my and these are indispensable, and they're like old friends. All of you book lovers out there, you love keeping your books. You have pride in your library. You've read every book in there, some multiple times. And to me, they're like old friends, but really like astronomy books. This one is a friend, has been one of my go-tos. That I bought it in. This is a American Nature Guide. All right, that has all kinds of interesting. There's your basic astronomy guides right there. And I'm going to show you a couple more like this that are popular at Books A Million or through Amazon. They have the constellation, and then they show you the deep sky objects, if you will, in there. There's the layout of the constellation. That is, let's get Orion the Hunter out there real quick. There's Orion the Hunter. All right. And descriptions of the constellation real quick, the bright stars and things you're going to find in it. Also, usually these have the sky charts for the month, north and south. This book is one of my indispensable books when I was writing a column on astronomy for over 20 years, a real quick read about how far away the stars are and so forth. And I believe I bought this for $6 at a used bookstore there over 25 years ago. And one of my favorite books, Ian Ridpath, is one of the great illustrators in astronomy. I'm going to talk about Sky and Telescope and Astronomy Magazine. I have astronomy here. This is called Sky News. Go out and buy you one of these, all right? The green screen, Marty's messing that up on there. Go out and buy astronomy. Is usually available at your Walmart. It is $7 or $8. There's always some good stories in there, but then it has in the center where are all the planets, all right, and a star chart, the monthly star chart on this one. Did somebody take it out? I may have taken. Oh, there we are. So you always have a monthly star chart. Sky Dome and highlights of that month. All right, this is one I just pulled out of a box, May 2017. But every May, the star chart's good except for the planets that would be located in it. All right, and any comets coming by. So you only need to buy one of these every other month to be up with the sky. But it's a good investment, and they really have a great deal for your annual membership on that. So go get those. Also, there's a lot of what's top 10 events for 2022. All right, there'll be some of those on the newsstands. And one thing I'm looking forward to is this August, we will be having Mars come back, all right, in the sky. So we're going to have what we call a conjunction with Mars in August. So we will be having some Mars mania, showing people every other year Mars comes close to the Earth and we can see the surface features with a backyard telescope. So we'll be looking forward to that. And a couple stars, a couple books that you want to look is Exploring the Universe at the Library, a good book about the history of the ancient astronomers like Ptolemy that started, put the everything around the Earth, was rotating around the Earth. That's Tycho Brahe, a great naked eye astronomer. And then, of course, you learn about the greats like Galileo, Kepler, and why they're so important in astronomy. One of these books is indispensable for your background knowledge of astronomy. And then you want to get into a little bit of the cosmology. This is Coming of Age in the Milky Way by Timothy Ferris. And this is a very well-known book. This book is from the 1980s, I believe. Timothy Ferris still gives talks. He was an avid writer for the magazines, 1988. And he sort of defined this writing of the cosmos for the layman, of course, that that the great Stephen Hawking wrote the about the Big Bang and all the universe, his famous book, is another one that's like this to get. And anything by Patrick Moore, the British astronomer who's passed away, he popularized astronomy, The Sky at Night. Once again, a book that was given to me out of a library that talks a lot in general terms about telescopes and observing and history. And in fact, Patrick Moore's books, some of them are just little short stories that he wrote as an astronomy educator. In Tales of the Night, reading the mythologies, all these constellations we're going to talk about, their story started with the people looking up at Capricorn. And I love these little books about astronomy legends and so forth. And I'm going to show you a couple more of those here in just a minute. Marty, let me get my stand out there. The dot-to-dots of the sky are particularly interesting to put together. For example, I've gone out stargazing with Marty and shown him a few things, and he doesn't see them exactly like I do, and that's okay. Of course, we brag about Marty being an electrical engineer, and that's part of how he's wired. But I can make out some of the ancient figures, even in some of the very faint stars. And that's the problem. All the stars are not the same brightness, and to connect the dot to dots sometimes is very difficult. Well, what does Curious George have about that? Curious George is the tailless monkey that is on PBS shows educating kids about manners and things like that. And this was all started by a person named H.A. Ray in 1950s, all right, even in the 40s. And here is Mr. H.A. Ray reading to kids a Curious George book in the 1970s. But what he did was kind of revolutionize astronomy in 1951 with this book. And this book is called The Stars and a Different Way to Look at Them. Okay. And this book was written in 1952. 1952 is the earliest copyright of it there, okay? And what he did was he looked at the stars in a different way, okay? Let's go back to three there, Marty. There we go. He looked at the stars in the non-traditional dot-to-dot that most people do, okay? But it's very educational about putting you on the surface of the Earth and looking up at the stars. There's a lot of education about that in here. Let me show you the... Yeah, he uses an umbrella to show you how the sky moves around with the Big Dipper there. Great book to have. I've seen it for a couple bucks on Amazon Smile. We're going to go to that book there. Fight me. There you go. Let me have that back, Marty, to show you. This is your traditional way to look at Gemini, the twins, with Castor and Pollux, the two equal bright stars there. And it's like two lines coming down to show that the two brother twins, the stars are almost the same. Well, what H.A. Ray did was he made it look like this, like the brothers are holding hands. And now you can see it a little bit better when you think of it that way, like their stick figure heads there. Because when you outline that, you go, well, I don't see two brothers. I see like a part of a rectangle, a big long rectangle or whatever. That way, you see what they're talking about with the brothers by connecting the dot to dots in a non-traditional way. This is the traditional way of looking at Leo the lion that I've seen for many years, and it does look like the body of the lion. Regulus on the right is the bright star. Denebula over here means tail in Arabic, the tail of the lion. In the mane is the backward question mark. But H.A. Ray wanted to look at like this, which to me, that doesn't help me as much as that does, as Leo. And you can imagine his legs down there if you wanted to connect dot to dot. But that's what H.A. Ray did, the guy that is famous for this little guy, Curious George, part of astronomy. Now you're staying curious with Curious George, and I bet you didn't know that about it. Also, there's a lot of things that went, a little background I was reading on this. There's a lot of talk about what kind of monkey is this, Marty, without a tail? Okay, there's baboons and so forth that don't have tails, but we digress. We're glad that you can stay curious with Curious George and us. And there is H.A. Ray. Well, I'm going to put up an easel here, and I'm going to show you a bunch of books here. And once again, right on top of the microphone, I don't need to be too loud. Marty's going to adjust the camera there. To my mess of books here. I love it. I love books. I'm reading two or three books all the time. Let's see. I've got at least two books going on right now. One of them by Ed Gibson. Yeah. Reading the book about Joe Ribello, his sci-fi thriller. And we hope to have him on and talk about that book here. Ed Gibson of Skylab 4 fame. Christopher Lusardi, here's some more books to answer your question, buddy, that we're so glad that you asked. You might regret it. Astronomy for Dummies, of course. You know, the reference for the rest of us. Yep, they have that out there, Marty. This is a very famous book by Guy Consolamango and Dan Davis called Turn Left at Apollo. This is definitely Turn Left at Orion. I said Apollo. Thank you, Marty. Turn Left at Orion. If I don't move this, these are going to fall off here. I can see it coming. Excuse me, folks. There we go. Get my library going there. Turn Left at Orion is one of the big ones that came out in the 80s. Beautiful sky charts showing you elementary things in the beginning about getting yourself acclimated to your backyard astronomy. Little tips like if you find the backyard astronomy place, where you can block out that neighbor's light that he never turns off, okay? And if you're looking through a telescope, make sure you're not looking over a neighbor's roof or the updrafts of the heat off the roof will mess things up. Anyway, you get an idea as I leaf through here. He goes individual constellations, some of the ways to draw the nebulas and galaxies in here. All right. Turn Left at Orion. And this is you'll find that. It's your favorite shopping place there. These are indispensable. Two books here, very much the same. Don Menzel and the Peterson Field Guide, okay, to astronomy manuals. These are what you really want to look for because, one, they're a nice size to handle out at the telescope, okay. They all have basically the same, as my favorite one I showed you there a little bit earlier, that's out of my reach now that I told you I bought for, oh, here, my astronomy book right here. These are all three the same type of book that gives you star charts and detailed about each constellation and a lot of observing tips in there, okay? So look for these. I know you can find them at the local bookstores, but these are good ones to find at your thrifty bookstores. Also, a moon map is indispensable because the moon is a good thing to look at, though you can't look at nebulas and galaxies. Look at the moon. And I'm looking through here. I don't think this one's got a good moon map in it, this Peterson guide. So this one does in the back, I know, because this is one of my favorite books. So those are good ones to find. These little field guides, they're usually pretty thick. They're packed with all the constellations in the northern hemisphere, usually. There are 88 constellations. Now, something we love to emphasize on backyard astronomy is binoculars, okay? So there are several books on binocular astronomy. You don't have to invest in a big telescope. If you got binoculars, you can enjoy looking at the all kinds of things with binoculars, and that helps you learn the constellations. After all, the constellations are the roadmap to what we call the celestial treasures, the nebulas and galaxies and star clusters that are out there. In fact, this is one I really recommend, Binocular Stargazing by Mike Reynolds. Mike Reynolds passed away. He was involved in Oakland, California at the Chabot Space and Science Museum, an expert in meteorology. And God bless you, Mike. There, he even signed that to me, to Mark Clear Skies at the Winter Star Party in 2006. In fact, there's a picture of Mike on the back there since I'm talking about him there. He is missed in the astronomy community, I guarantee you that, and has wrote several great books on binocular, A Guide to Viewing Stars, Moon, Planets, and More with Binoculars. And here's another one, a classic, Wilhelm Bell, Publishers of Astronomy. Again, showing you charts, pictures of things to see, observing tips, and so forth with binoculars, all right? All right, let's put that there. Mic's up there. We're getting a good old library built up there. Self-teaching guides to astronomy can be popular. Now, these are very technical. This is like taking a college class, okay? And you can find some of these that you can actually do you homeschoolers. This is what you want to look for that has lessons in it. And you're self-teaching yourself astronomy there. But let's go to a couple other books here on stargazing, the constellations. Here's another two, Richard Berry and Anything by Will Tyrian. Will Tyrian and Ian Ridpath right there are two giants of the map world. This is what this was the editor of the Richard Berry was the editor of Astronomy magazine for many years, a very intelligent man. He got into another career afterwards, but I like this little book from him. All right, it's been out in the wet with me there. I think Richard signed that to me at a star party. Yep, one time there. Good guy, really did a lot to promote. Here are star charts. Again, another more serious star chart that by the month, you can see all 24 sky charts. I'm just randomly flipping through there. These are good to have, okay? I was mentioning to Marty when I said about this, these books will find you, you know, that by how you look at things. Not everybody looks at things the same way as far as charts and photographs and stuff. So these books, I guarantee you, will find you. There's a lot of specialty books out there, like Sky Phenomenon, A Guide to Naked Eye Observing, okay? Like Moon Dogs, which are those sun dogs, or those bright lights on each side of the sun, all right? Why they're there and so forth. In fact, this is a bonus book because for me, because it contains all kinds of poetry in the back that I've used in my astronomy talks and writing. The Urban Astronomer's Guide. I told you. You were going to regret that you asked me about books. The Urban Astronomer, that's what we are, as urban astronomers. And so there's a whole series of that. Stars of the First People. This was handed me today. This is legends of the people around the world, okay? The first people of Earth, the Native American culture, the Greek constellations, all right? This is mostly about the Native Americans here and how they saw different legends and stuff in the stars. And then you go out and look at that, and you can just put yourself in their shoes 500 years ago looking at the stars like this. There are definitely non-books that you can buy. This is a real cool thing. Hey, Brother Craig. He bought me this for a Christmas gift one time. They are little pullouts of the month. I just happened to pull out December there, and you open it up. There's the star chart, all right, dark and light, and data on the back about what you're looking at in December. So these are neat little things to have. There's August, and comes in a nice little folder there. And you go out on this full moon night, and you stay inside, and you look and see, like, next week, what do I want to look at? And some of them get really sophisticated, Marty, as we're coming to the home stretch here. Here is a gorgeous Stargazer's Handbook. This is an atlas of the sky. This is the artwork of serious photographers, not just doing galaxies, but doing star images out there for you. And these are beautiful tabletop books that once again, on rainy nights, cloudy nights, you can look back and then plan what you're going to see and envision it in color. So to end, we got two little things I want to talk about is books about the planets, all right? And there's all kinds of books as you're looking, getting ready to see Mars here in August. And we'll be watching Mars from about July, June. It'll be big enough to see pretty good. And that'll be about as big as Jupiter is in a telescope right now. And so we'll be seeing it for 3 or 4 months. But to buy books about how to look at it and so forth is good. Here is a great book of the planets by Deva Sobel. She wrote a book that was a big hit. She's also written a book called Galileo's Daughter, about the letters of Galileo's nun daughter to him when he was under house arrest. And I met her in June 2010, had lunch with her, and was around her. Deva Sobel, she said, for Mark, one of the nicer earthlings, Marty. So Deva Sobel thinks I'm nice. I know Marty thinks I'm nice. But treasure these type of things and to meet people that aren't everyday authors. Every book, if you're into cookbooks, if you're into history books in the Civil War, whatever, you have your own little people out there that you love to read. Deva Sobel's one of them, and I was so proud to have met her and had lunch with her a couple times. Again, Stars and Planets, another book. You might be able to pick this up for $5 at your bookstore, telling you about some of the mythology of Saturn, through all the cultures. I love those. And then you might find a book about women astronomers reaching for the stars. I bought this for $1, all right? And I have learned a lot about the women astronomers. There's Henrietta Leavitt. She's very famous. There's all kinds of women astronomers out there, and I'm so pleased to see a lot of women engineers in NASA and Jet Propulsion Lab and SpaceX. And finally, what we've been talking about, that big bright thing in the sky that you can't see Orion's Nebula very good this for the next couple of days because it's so bright, and that's the moon. And, of course, you need a good book of the moon as well as a nice map or two of the moon there. Look at that Rand McNally map there from I love these old maps. McDonald's even had a map that they gave out, Marty. This is a map I use a lot at the it folds out and like this, and so it's handy to look at a feature and flop it over and then really digest what you're looking at, what crater, looking at the angles of the crater there. But this is the this book now, if you can find it, is worth over $100. I wish I'd bought a couple more of them. This is Ruckel. Anton Ruckel is without a doubt one of the most beautiful artists of the moon and planets and galaxies. Anything that you see of his is just gorgeous. There's the famous Kepler with all kinds of information about it. And when you're looking at it through the telescope, you can see the detail pop out as you put your eye to it. Ptolemais, another beautiful crater there. And then, of course, it gives you images in the back. You see this for $5 at a yard sale or bookstore. That is, you can, honestly, they're worth easy $50 all day long. And most times I see them for over $100. And then there are these ancient books of the moon from the 1950s, all right, that I love those. Let me show you one of the classic moon pictures in here of the way we thought it was going to be. Let's see quickly. There we go. So we are glad that you're all staying a little. There we are. There's a old-timey looking rocket landing on the moon right there. In this book, a Splendor book, is from 1961. I love these. Oh, this is in great shape too. So anyway, enjoyed sharing you some of my library and a little bit of how crazy I am about books and these astronomy books. Guarantee you they will make any cloudy night go by quickly and you'll learn something. Marty?
Yeah, Cliff Watson said, Pam Hoffman, space book from Everyday Space.
Pam Hoffman? All right, Everyday Space. He's recommending a book there. All right. Thank you, Cliff. met Cliff during the I met Cliff during the annual eclipse, the total solar eclipse we had when they were down there.
7 a.m. down there.
And somebody, Space Resources about astronaut books today. Well, we can do another whole story about astronaut books because, boy, 355 people rode the shuttle, and it seems like everybody's writing a book about it. So we can look at that. And Marty just passed me a note here that the SpaceX launch has been postponed till tomorrow at 7.04 p.m. And I would guess that's high winds, Marty, because it's pretty windy around here. Yeah, it is pretty windy around here today and a little bit chilly. It's in the 60s, and you'd think it was in the 20s where Tom and Mark Usiak are today, because I saw some pictures of people's frost and windows covered with ice and so forth. So hope everybody's being safe on this Martin Luther King Day. Thank you, Marty. We appreciate hearing from everybody. Appreciate hearing from my buddy Cliff. Tell all your mates down under there, buddy, to look us up. If it's 4 o'clock here, he's up early, Marty. It's 7 or 8 in the morning there. I thought it was 12 hours.
7 o'clock in Auslan.
All right, 7 o'clock in Auslan. He's having his brekkie. He's having his eggs and bacon. And Cliff, swear one day I want to get down there and see Orion upside down in the large and small Magellanic clouds. Maybe we'll make that happen. But thank you all, like Cliff Watson in Pomona, Australia, for staying curious with us, staying star curious today. Thank you, Marty Winkle, for running a beautiful board today. And man, I got to haul all these books back to my library. But don't mind it. I love doing it. And tomorrow we've got a wonderful conversation with a real astronomer who is going, he's already got time logged out on the Webb telescope. When it gets up running, he's going to tell us all about the beautiful Webb telescope that's ready to go. He's worked on the Hubble telescope. And of course, I'm talking about Eric Perlman. And Eric Perlman will be here with us, an astronomer from Florida Institute of Technology. Be right here next to me to help you all stay curious tomorrow. So thank you on behalf of Marty, our whole team here at the American Space Museum. I'm Mark Marquette. Thank you for being here to stay star curious on Stay Curious, and we'll see you tomorrow to bridge the space between us.